I bow to all the worshippers of truth and love. After hearing so many things about yourself, you just start wondering that I never knew all these things were there. As kind as they are, Sahaja Yogis, full of gratefulness, for I've done nothing for them. It's just in my own nature, it works out. Like the Mother Earth, which sprouts the seed in her own nature, in my own nature, you get your realization. I haven't achieved anything whatsoever. Whatever is in your innate quality, you can never be aware of that. But I must say, I congratulate all the Sahaja Yogis for achieving this state. This is a very difficult thing to achieve. As you know, that human beings are crowded by so many things that it is very difficult situation to understand what is absolute. Actually, we have also created some things around us which act like jails, bondages, which are detrimental to our ascent. I don't know how these scientists of that level could take to Sahaja Yoga so well. I would say their pure intelligence must have pointed out to them that Sahaja Yoga is a simple method by which you achieve your last breakthrough. As in a spacecraft, we have containers between containers, one into another, and when the speed of the first one, which is just a normal speed, is accelerated, then only it could go to that height where is the space. And to solve this problem, they built in a method by which the first container explodes, which gives an acceleration to another, then the second one explodes and gives acceleration to the third one. It goes on till ultimately the spacecraft enters into the space where there is no gravitational force. In the same way, Sahaja Yoga acts. Human beings have evolved through this explosive method, which we call as evolution. So we have come to a state where we are human beings. Now we are on a human awareness level. At this stage, we have to have the breakthrough. And for this breakthrough, something has to trigger it. As Dr. Warlikar has told you, that even one wrong cell, which represents negativity, can act and spoil all the rest of them. In the same way, one good cell can activate it to do something good, like it has to be triggered. I told him that DNA is to be triggered by outer force to start. There is carbon, there is nitrogen, there is oxygen, hydrogen, all built in amino acids. But there has to be a triggering from outside. And for that, in our country, when we had the knowledge of the roots of this knowledge, we found out that the triggering comes because there are avatars, there are incarnations from the divine. So there is a parallel system that works to trigger it. One side is the evolution going on, another side is the entry of a triggering agent, what we call as an incarnation or what we call as the avatar. Now this meeting point can only be achieved when human beings have reached the state of self-realization. Otherwise, a doctor will have a photograph of Christ and he'll say, this is the savior I have, or he may have Sri Ganesha in his house and he'll say, all right, I worship Sri Ganesha. But he would never try to understand that this Sri Ganesha exists within your body, that it's a landmark of your evolution. On the Muladhara Chakra, he exists and it is only to be awakened. He won't believe that Christ exists on your Ajna Chakra. Till the Kundalini is awakened, how can they believe that these deities, which are different, I should say, milestones of our evolution, exist and that they act on the parasympathetic nervous system, affecting the activity of the others, we can say other plexuses, which are physical, or also say ductless glands, and all the nervous system can be acted upon by them. For example, if we can just form a idea like a scientist should, because if he's an open-minded person, he must keep his mind open to this hypothesis that is put forward before them. That supposing there is someone inside your being which controls an activity which cannot be explained. For example, the acetylcholine and adrenaline, these two chemicals are chemicals. They are just chemicals and the chemicals act the way they are. But when they are in the body, they act very differently. Sometimes they relax, sometimes they augment. So the doctors are honest and they say that the mode of conduct of these chemicals in the human beings cannot be understood. Another simple example I'll give you, that the body of a human being is such that any foreign body, if it enters into the body of a human being, is thrown out. It is not tolerated. But when the fetus is formed in the mother's womb, it's not thrown out at all. On the contrary, it is looked after, it is nourished, and at the right time, it is thrown out. Who does that? If I say it's done by Sri Ganesha, nobody is going to believe it, but it is. So if you can say, for example, in a country, if there is a problem you have, if you can go to the king of that country, you can solve the problem. It's very easy. So if the area which is covered by these deities are kshetras, as we call them, if you can approach them somehow, these deities, and if you can awaken them, they can immediately release energies to solve the problem of that area. It's so simple as that. And to understand this, first of all, you have to be a realized soul. Now it is a vicious circle. When you are not a realized soul, then you start asking questions. You say, how can it be? It's not possible. How can Ganesha be within us? How can there be this? Now by saying this, or by talking about it, nobody can convince you. Like somebody is blind. How can you talk to a blind person about the colors that you see? It's just a waste of energy, and also it is very disgusting because the other fellow gets so frustrated with you and you also feel disgusted that you cannot explain to a blind man about the colors. But supposing, if you can open the eyes of a blind man and if he sees the colors, then it is very easy to explain. And that is what Sahaja Yoga means. Sahaja. Sahaja means with, ja means born, is born with you. For that, you don't need any race, particular race or community or caste or religion or anything. Because innately we are all human beings. We all laugh the same way. We all smile the same way. We feel bashful the same way. We look at people and people know what we are feeling about. For that, you don't need that this is a Greek face, so Greek face laughs in a different way, or an English face laughs in a different way. So basically, we are all just the same But God has created this variety to make life interesting and beautiful. Inside ourselves, the innermost part of us is this special instrument which God has created within us in different yugas or in different times. When we were born as amoeba, it started, or we can say as carbon. So we start with carbon, ending up to the human level. Now at the human level, we have crossed the agya, that is Christ's advent. That happened 2000 years back. Now the only job is to break through here, to come to some compromise. We have to know that Christ would not tell us lies. Was he telling us lies that you have to have your baptism, that Christ said that you are to be born again? But instead of understanding him, what he said, that you are to be born again, we just self-certify ourselves, I'm born again, I'm a Christian because I've been baptized artificially by some priest. Or some Brahmin also says that I'm a Brahmin because he has a ceremony when he was 8 years of age, he becomes a Brahmin, or born in a Brahmin family. You cannot be born in any caste or community, you are a human being. Straightforward thing is that. That is what God's laws are. He treats you as a human being. He doesn't treat you as an Indian or an American or an English or anyone. For him, this world is one, and that you are a human being, which are at the epitome of your evolution, and that you have to now break through. When you break through, what happens is that your spirit, which is the reflection of God Almighty in your heart, starts emitting light in your attention. That means now, if you put attention to someone, you can feel the different centers on your fingertips. Our Dr. Rustam is making a thorough study of Quran, and my father also translated Quran Sharif into Hindi, and I happen to be very close to him on this. And what he has told, that Muhammad Sahib has clearly described at length, Kamaya, that is the Kayama, is the evolutionary process by which a state of, we can say, revelation will come. At that time of revelation, at that time of resurrection, your hands will speak. He has clearly said it. Even namaz is nothing but raising of the kundalini. Of course, in this great country of ours, thousands of years, people have been talking about kundalini. 14,000 years back, you can say that people have talked about kundalini awakening, like Markandeya. Even before that, Indra got his realization. But it was never accepted in India that you can get realization just by joining some organized religion or anything. That's why religion was not organized in this country, thank God for that. Once the religion is organized, then the unrealized people start organizing the religion the way they are. And then they create a big barrier for people who want to achieve reality. Reality is what it is. You cannot make it, you cannot conceive it, you cannot force it to be the way you want to be. You cannot organize it either. It is what it is, and you have to see to it that it is so. For that, what he said, to surrender. Surrender doesn't mean that you give away your money, give away your brains. It means that ego, which is there, which says, no, 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 how can that be? This is a personality which we have developed within ourselves, which makes everything look mythical, which is reality. You start challenging everything that is reality. Now, between this vicious circle, the breakthrough is very difficult, because if you talk to a scientist, it's very difficult. You see, they will start asking questions to you, like, I would say, a person like Dr. Warlikar. I mean, he's so knowledgeable. But somehow, I have this knowledge also about atoms, this, that. So he gets impressed by my knowledge that, but it's nothing great that I have, it's just I know it. So if I tell him, he feels impressed that I know all these things. But still, if he does not want to accept to go further with it, that this knowledge is useless, this doesn't work out. You see, what works out is this all-pervading power of God, which they do not want to believe till they have an experience of it. I'll tell you an experience, how people experience it. In the beginning, when I was working on some 7 English people, you will be surprised, for 4 years I was struggling with them. 4 years for 7 English people. And it was so difficult. Imagine Christ, who was just given a public life for 3.5 years, what could he have achieved? And after that, after their realization and all that, one of them, he said, "All right, Mother, you said that once you are a realized soul, you get charged with collective consciousness." I said, "Yes. Your central nervous system expresses that. That is what Veda is, from Veda, that is what we call it, is realization." So he said, "Then I should know about my father who is not telephoned to me." I said, "All right, you just find out. Put your hands and ask the question." He asked the question and he gets a burning on this finger here. I told him, "Now this means your father must be down with very bad bronchitis, because this is Vishuddhi chakra on the right hand side is bronchitis. These are all the centers of your father." He couldn't believe it. So he telephoned to his mother, and mother came on the phone and she said exactly the same sentence: "Your father is down with very bad bronchitis." So when you start seeing that this is something beyond, that whatever communication system you have, whatever computers you have, whatever you have created is really the copy of what you are inside. But when the inside starts working, you are amazed at the fantastic qualities you have, the fantastic powers you have, and you just start using them as soon as you develop complete faith through experience, not a blind faith, but through experience. Then you start using them and you are amazed how it works out. Like in India, people get realization with other difficulties. So you see, one gentleman told me, "Mother, if you ask them, who is your Kulaswamini, and ask the Kulaswamini to say, is Mother your Kulaswamini?" And vibrations work out. This is the knowledge of the roots. And to go to the roots, as Shri Krishna has said, you have to go back in the urdhvagati, to the ascent, to the brain. The roots are in the brain and the awareness goes downward. And when it grows downward, we go to adhogati, downward movement. In that, we start becoming nothing but ultimately a sex point or something like that. So to achieve the knowledge of the roots, we have to have an urdhvagati, that is the ascent. And for the ascent, there is kundalini. Though Shri Krishna has not talked about kundalini, he has not said a word, but we are so grateful to Ganeshwara, who was our great poet and a saint of Maharashtra, who very clearly in the 6th chapter said that it is the kundalini which gives you the ascent. Of course, 14,000 years back, Markandeya has talked about it so, but the way then Kabira or Nanaka talked about it clearly, we should now know that we have to have this ascent. We are not on the absolute point. Whatever is our knowledge is not absolute. You put 10 children with their eyes tight and ask them, "What's the problem with this gentleman?" They will all raise their one finger, supposing this one, means the person always feels guilty. But if they raise this finger and this finger, the fellow is suffering from angina. Without opening their eyes, they will tell you the same thing, because knowledge not only is absolute, but is the same. Whether I'm wearing a sari with a zari or not, you can see with your own eyes. In the same way, whether this gentleman has this problem or not, you all can see with the eyes of your hands. And you can make it out, what's the matter with this person. Now, if you just learn how to overcome that, if you can find out how to do it, if it is decoded, the message is decoded to you and just told to you how to find out and how to rectify, then you are a master. And that hardly takes for some people, even 8 days are sufficient for them to master it. It has to be simple. It cannot be difficult. People think that it has to be very difficult, kundalini awakening has to be difficult. It could be for people. I would say that, supposing you put a seed inside this wood, it won't sprout. And then you'll say it's very difficult to sprout the seed. Put it in the proper place, which is authorized for sprouting the seed. And then it works out spontaneously, has to work out spontaneously. And when it works out, it's the easiest thing to do because you are on the principle, on the essence of everything. Once you are on the essence, you can create so many permutations and combinations. And this is exactly is Sahaja Yoga. I don't know, all these tributes have been paid to me, it's very kind of them. And the age now I have reached also is something says that now Sahaja Yoga has to prosper very fast. And it has to. Men have to. Women have to become self-realized souls. That's the part that God has asked us to play. Those even who do not believe in God, like Russia, China, also they feel the vibrations. I have given realization to many people in Russia and also in China, thanks to my husband's job that I travel. And they have tremendous respect for me, tremendous respect. And they think that there is something, a power like that. And they have been asking me, what sort of a power is this? We want to know all about it. A day will come when it will spread there also, though it is spreading more in the democratic countries because there is freedom to spread it. But in the democratic countries, there is also freedom from demonic things to develop more. And that's why is another fight one has to do. So the life becomes easier if the person who is a seeker tries to find the truth in a truthful, honest manner. We have to verify it by saying, what sort of a life the Guru is leading? What are his leanings? What is his seeking? What does he do? You can find out. It's very easy to find out. But if you just want to have a retainer like a Guru, you can have him. The mistake is not so much of the Gurus because they are out for a business. But the mistake is of the seekers because they do not want to understand that you cannot purchase God. You cannot purchase a saint. We have here Tukarama, as you have seen it, that when Shivaji Maharaj, the great king of this, noble king of this Maharashtra, brought all the ornaments and everything for his wife, he told her, no, we don't need it. We are just villagers. What do we need these ornaments for a queen? You are not a queen. You better return it. But if you are a queen, you have to live like a queen. But that doesn't mean that a person who lives like a queen is attached to it. Whether you wear it or not makes no difference to such a person. Thank God we have so many examples in this country of these great saints. And this, especially this Maharashtra, has so many saints who were such great incarnations, I should say, who brought forth the main essence that you have to have your self-realization. Otherwise, this human life is useless. It is all going to be wasted. All your endeavors, all your enterprises will end up into nothing, into zero, unless and until you are a self-realized soul. That's why I always say that Maharashtrians are about to become Sahaja Yogis. It's very easy to make a Maharashtrian a Sahaja Yogi. In the same way, it is easy for Indians also. And surprisingly, so many seekers are born in America. So many. So many are born in England. So many are born all over the world. There are 16 countries where we are operating. And I find so many are born. But the problem is that they have no knowledge whatsoever about the roots. No knowledge about the knowledge of the roots. They think the tree is everything. So for them, those people who can maneuver or manipulate or can find out ways of impressing them can cheat them. It's the greatest sin to cheat a seeker. But people are doing it from this country and we should be ashamed of them, the way they are behaving. In 1972, when we had a big lecture on in Kawasi Jahangir Hall, I named them, I told their names and I said, this is what is happening. Still I saw so many Indians going after them and getting hit. Everywhere they have really created such menace, such poverty, such illness that a mother can only weep and say that these are the seekers of truth and mislaid and deceived by these people. So all of you who are Sahaja Yogis, who are felicitating me today here on this birthday, I have to say that I have been traveling too much. I want you to be my hands, to help me out. Go out all the way. everywhere that is possible, spend your time to spread the news that everybody can get realization. You are all empowered to give realization. Dr. Warren must have given to thousands, Mr. Modi must have given to thousands, Rustam must have given to thousands. You all can give realization. So many of you who are sitting here have given realization to so many people. So first of all, you have to give them realization and establish their realization and make them empowered fully as you are, and then let them go ahead. It's very simple to enlighten another light because you are enlightened, and then this light can enlighten another light. But first of all, we must respect our self-realization, develop into it, because that's your glory. That's what you have to achieve. That's the end of life. That's where your human awareness finishes and you jump into the space where there is no thought, no worries, nothing. You are in the realm of God's kingdom. Then He looks after you. So many miracles now people are talking about me. Mother, you have done this. Mother, you have done that. I just keep quiet. Because it is the all-pervading power which is like an ether which acts everywhere. It's like the ether that gives you television scenery or a vision. But this is more than that. Because when you put your attention to somebody across, then this attention, as if from the television the man gets out and treats you, gets you well and goes back. This attention acts, and this is the attention of God's love. So the whole thing boils down to the love of God. We have never used the power of love of God. Whatever we have issues, whatever we fight for, is some sort of a hatred. Never the power of love. And when we use the power of love, it's the most effective, most accurate, most efficient, and so clever. The whole intelligence is so much above all the stupidity and all the crookery of the world that you are amazed how suddenly you find everything is worked out. You have to trust yourself. You all have this power, just get it and build it up. I hope this birthday of mine will give you one request from me, that please, please devote your time to your self-evolution and for the whole world. Don't live for yourself. You have to live for others. You have to give it to others. This is to be spread if you have to save the world from all the calamities that are so shocking. May God bless you all. After this, we are going to have our program in a little dance recital by Miss Warlikar, and then there will be Chitti Babu's program, which is very interesting. And if you don't mind, I would like to watch that sitting down, if you allow me. But nobody should come to touch my feet. If you allow me to sit down, I'll be able to enjoy it more. But for that, I have to request that nobody should come and touch my feet. Because any time I want to go down, everybody start touching my feet, the whole program goes off. Otherwise, I'll sit here. Is it promised? So what's that?